Let's open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 21. We're continuing our study through the book of Matthew. Jesus has been dealing with the problem of self-ambition in the disciples, shows lessons in humility. Today, Jesus demonstrates that humility in fulfilling a very definite prophecy, riding into Jerusalem from the Mount of Olives on the colt of a donkey. Let's read together, beginning in verse 1 of chapter 21. Now when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, 'Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" This is found in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, amidst God's judgment of the nations and the deliverance that he has provided to and promises to Israel. Continuing, the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. A very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. When the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, "Hosanna, the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Hosanna means save now. Son of David, a title for the Messiah. It would be well known then in that group of literally thousands of people that had gathered there in the city of Jerusalem, had come in from all the regions around about to celebrate the Passover, that they were crying out, "Save us now, Son of David, the Messiah." When they had come to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, "Who is this?" It's an interesting question when you hear everyone telling who he is. "Hosanna, save us now. Messiah, save us now." Well, who is this? Well, they said, "He is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee." Let's pray together. Lord, we're so thankful for the privilege that we have of studying the Bible. We're so thankful, Lord, that we have clear insight from the Old Testament and now from the New concerning the prophecies and fulfillment of prophecy accomplished by your first coming. And Lord, this gives us great assurance that you will fulfill everything you said about those things related to your second coming and your soon coming kingdom. We do join our hearts with those who say, "Save now." Your word tells us, "Pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." But Lord, we know that there is still many things to accomplish before that day comes to pass in which you will literally intervene and save the nation and people of Israel. And for many of us, there is still a day coming when we will experience the fullness of the salvation that you've provided us in Christ, and that day when you will physically return to the earth and again ride into Jerusalem, delivering the people of Israel and establishing your earthly kingdom and seated upon the throne as King of kings and Lord of lords here in the earth. We long for that day. We do cry out from our own hearts, save now. But we know that there's a day coming when that will come to pass. And in this period of time in which we wait, we trust you and your sovereignty. We know who you are. Committing ourselves to you and studying and knowing and declaring those things we know to others around us. We thank you for the privilege. We give you praise today. In Jesus' name, amen. This is a very specific prophecy. Now, there are many that we've already covered, and this one in particular, to me, is of great interest. Today, we're going to take some time. We're going to be going throughout the Bible. We're going to turn our pages an awful lot, so keep your Bibles handy. As we look at a few of the things that are very important to us in this study, an observation of the fulfillment of prophecy. Now, Jesus coming into the city of Jerusalem was foretold years before, hundreds of years before. We'll read about it in the book of Daniel. We'll read about it from the book of Psalms. We'll read about it in Exodus. The things that were accomplished there were desired by God, and the things that were intended to be accomplished there by the people of Israel at the time were not fulfilled, and therefore they became discouraged. When they were crying out on the 10th of Nisan, a very specific day, a Sunday, when Jesus rode into Jerusalem, they were saying, "Save us now." What they were asking for was salvation from the tyranny and the overarching authority of Rome. They wanted to have their own country back. They wanted their own freedoms. They didn't want to be controlled by the Romans. Some of the Jews were oppressed greatly by the Romans. You've heard in Jesus' own words, if they compel you to go a mile, go with them too. That related to the fact that a Roman guard was able to talk to any Jewish person at any point in time and say, "Look, I'm walking in this direction. I'm going to have this big burden to carry, and I want you to carry it for me." And even if you were going in the opposite direction, you had to stop what you were doing and pick up the baggage, whatever that baggage might be, that Roman guard would have you to carry, and you had to walk with him for 1 mile. And Jesus goes beyond that and says, if they compel you to go one, go two, as a testimony of servanthood. The disciples have been arguing about who will be the greatest in the kingdom. They've had all kinds of discussion about this with the Lord. As you remember, even the wife of Zebedee, the mother of James and John, had approached Jesus and said, "Can my kids sit at your left and right hand?" And still now the Lord goes on to tell them about servanthood and then demonstrates that servanthood by riding into Jerusalem on the colt, the young colt of a donkey, humbly. Jesus could have ridden in on a stallion, white, muscly, could have had great fanfare, but no, he chose to go in humbly. And as the King of Peace, he rides on a colt that had never been ridden before. I don't know about you, but if you've ever been around a new horse or a young donkey, the first time you get on them, they don't like it. Throw you right off, you know, best they can. So squirm out from under you, sit down, you name it. They don't want you around. And Jesus has the coats of these laid upon this donkey, and he gets on and he rides in. Now, it's interesting as we look at the text, because we'll see in one case there's only a mention of the colt. Another case here in Matthew, we have the donkey and the colt. So the mother and child, makes no difference. It's just a simple omission in one of the other passages, no contradiction. It could be that by having the mother of the colt there along, it would give an additional sense of peace to the little colt. Either way, Jesus comes from the top of the mountain, the Mount of Olives, and rides down through the valley and then back up the other side into the city of Jerusalem through what is believed to be the Eastern Gate. And we'll talk a little bit more about that today. And so the people remember these words. Tell the daughter of Zion, verse 5, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Now, this is placed in the midst of a deliverance where God is telling the people of Israel that he will deliver them from the surrounding nations. And so they were looking for that salvation then and there. Now, we know today that there is what is referred to as near and far fulfillment, or as we've called it, the law of double reference, sometimes the law of multiple reference, that Jesus did not come at that time to set the people of Israel free from the tyranny of Rome. And they were crying out on the 10th of Nisan, save us now, Messiah. Within 4 days, they will turn against the Lord because he didn't do what they asked him to do. It's interesting to me how many people treat the Lord that way today. Somebody will say, well, I tried the Christian thing and it didn't work for me. I prayed once, God didn't answer me. We want God to do things our way, in our time. See, we have forgotten in the Western culture that God is God and we are not. We think of God as our servant. He is our slave, our errand boy. And if we say to our errand boy, do this or do that, and he doesn't do it the way we think he should, we become very upset with God. Everything falls apart. There's pandemonium and chaos. Some of you will say, well, I had a child die. I'm mad at God. Well, it's not God's fault. Well, I prayed that God would do something specific for me and he didn't do it. And so then they reject God or they throw a temper tantrum. And man, do we need to learn the lessons of the sovereign God and being able to go before him and say, God, you're God, we're not. Do what is pleasing to you. We pray according to your will. Amen. I remember in 1976, I was 16 years old, and I prayed for a 1976 Mercury Capri V6 automatic transmission, air conditioning, bucket seats, two-door coupe, hatchback, very sporty. And I remember going to the car lot and seeing the car and saying, oh, God, please, I want that car. God gave me that car. It was the worst car I ever had. Now, it's probably no surprise that you haven't seen too many Mercury Capris running about. In fact, I haven't seen one in years, probably because of the problems that they had. But had I known then to say, God, if it's your will, can I have that Mercury Capri? And then if I didn't get the car, I would have certainly been happy because I knew that I had prayed, not my will, but thine be done. We are too often about our own agenda. We want what we want, and we want it now. You've heard the expression, Lord, give me patience and give it to me right now. Patience comes through great trial, doesn't it? Where the Lord shapes us and molds us and makes us and turns us from our own way to his way in his sovereignty, accomplishing his own good pleasure in accordance to his will. Well, when they say, save now, and he didn't. 4 days later, when they crucified the Lord, the majority of those similar people, great numbers of people, thousands of people, scattered in every direction and were nowhere to be found when Jesus was crucified. Even then, his disciples, the 12, still there, Judas, and they themselves probably quite celebratory as they saw the multitudes only 4 days later would scatter. As you know, by that time, Judas had betrayed the Lord, deserted him. Peter denied him. All but John left there, or all had scattered but John, who was left there by the cross, Jesus crucified between two thieves. They didn't get what they wanted. They didn't get it their way. But this passage of Scripture is so powerful. I realize that for those of you that are Bible students and quite scholarly, many of you, some of the things I'm going to share today are things you already know. And admittedly, I find myself, like so many pastors, tempted to give you something new. I think there's a danger in always looking for something new. False teaching is often surfaced by a pastor or a leader or a teacher that want to always tickle your ears with something you don't know. And I recognize that some of the things that I'll tell you today, you know, but for review, I think it's important, and especially for those of you that don't know these things, it will be critical to your understanding of who Jesus is. He is the Son of David. He is the Messiah. He is the sinless one. He is the one that will save, but he saves in his own time his own people. And so let's go to Psalm 118 to begin with. Psalm 118. If you don't know this, most of the Psalms are the prayer life of Jesus. Now you might say to yourself, now wait a minute, how could they be the prayer life of Jesus? They were written before he was born. Well, that would be true of his incarnation, but it is not true of his existence. He is the pre-incarnate Christ. He is from eternity past. When we read in Genesis, in the beginning, God, we see the plural noun, Elohim. Let us make man in our image. Jesus was there from the beginning, without beginning, as God. And he, inspiring the scripture and even inspiring these, the Psalms, oftentimes we can look at these and we can see the prayer life of Jesus. And we can see some of his triumphal entry into Jerusalem in these passages. We can see Israel in these passages. We can see the prayer life. And we can also see the tragedy of this event. As glorious as it was, that what we call the triumphal entry is quite tragic, really, in the disappointment of those who had their own agenda and yet in the accomplishment of the things of God. Verse 1, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Let Israel now say, his mercy endures forever. Let the house of Aaron now say, his mercy endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord now say, his mercy endures forever. I called on the Lord in distress, and the Lord answered me and set me in a broad place. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? The Lord's preparing to enter into Jerusalem for his final 4 days prior to his crucifixion. I am certain that in his humanness, he said, what can man do to me? I'm going to fear the Lord. Blessed be the Lord. His mercy endures forever. And let Israel now say, his mercy endures forever. The Lord is for me among those who help me. Therefore, I shall see my desire on those who hate me. He knows he's going into a crowd of many that will turn against him. Therefore, I shall see my desire on those who hate me. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in men or man. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. I'm going to trust in the Lord. All nations surrounded me, but in the name of the Lord, I will destroy them. Now, this could be pictured in a millennial context. It could also be pictured in the context of Israel. Now, recognizing that the Zechariah 9:9 passage, the king will come riding on a donkey, comes in the midst of a passage of scripture where all the nations are surrounding Israel and God is going to deliver them. This will happen at the time of the second coming, at another triumphal entry of Christ, at the time when he does come riding on a white horse. All nations surround me, but in the name of the Lord I will destroy them. They surrounded me. Yes, they surrounded me, but in the name of the Lord I will destroy them. They surrounded me like bees. They are quenched like a fire of thorns. And in the name of the Lord, I will destroy them. You pushed me violently that I might fall, but the Lord helped me. I can't help but think about when Christ was falling under the weight of the cross. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. The voice of rejoicing and salvation in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Boy, can Israel say that. He chastened me. It'll appear as though Israel is going to be completely wiped out, but the Lord will deliver Israel in due time, in his own time. They cried out, save now. And he said, no, save later, but save nonetheless. Open to me, verse 19, the gates of righteousness, and I will go through them. And I can't help but think about Jesus coming down that Mount of Olives and crossing that valley and going back up the other side, up to the city of Jerusalem and going through, I would suggest, the eastern gate, right into the temple square, right where all the people were there celebrating. As this young colt is bringing him in, and as they're throwing their coats and palm branches before him, and the donkey is walking on these branches and on their clothing, and as he is seated on this little donkey, and the coats upon that donkey, as Jesus is seated there on this peaceful little animal, going in humbly, and they cry out, save now. Open to me the gates of righteousness. I will go through them, and I will praise the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous shall enter. The righteous one. I will praise you, for you have answered me, for you have become my salvation. However, in the midst of all of this, in the midst of this trial, inserted these horrifying words, these disappointing words, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Well, it's glory to know that he will become the chief cornerstone, but it is so tragic to think that the stone has been rejected by those very builders. This was the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. God is the Lord, and he has given us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. You are my God, I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. I mean, you talk about all these things going on at the same time. The preparation for binding the sacrifice. He was nailed to a cross of wood on a hill in which it stood. You guys know the lyric. And here, the horns of the altar, the place of safety, where refuge will be given. And God, the Lord, has given light. If I am lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. I will illuminate. And then Jesus, who says, oh, you are my God, I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Now, all this was done on a Sunday. Now, we see this as the Passion Week, as part of the Passion Week. 8 days in whole, starting on a Sunday, and resurrected before it began to dawn on the following Sunday, and then Jesus' appearance on that second Sunday, the eighth day in that Passion Week, if you will, a new beginning manifest. And it's interesting to me as we begin to study this that there was some very unique prophecy given and very specific things that the children of Israel should have understood but didn't. And I want to take some time then to just develop this a little bit for you by looking at the parallel passage of the Matthew 21 to Luke chapter 19. And so if you would, go with me to Luke chapter 19 as we read it together and we find some other insights. We're going to begin reading at verse 28. So Luke chapter 19, verse 28. I'm going to begin reading while you're still turning. Most of the beginning of this is familiar to the Matthew passage. When he said this, he went on ahead going up to Jerusalem, and it came to pass when he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany at the mount called Olivet, he sent two of his disciples saying, go into the village opposite you, where you will enter, you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, why are you loosing it? Thus you shall say to him, because the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent went their way and found it just as he said. This was an interesting insight as well. Jesus was functioning with the gifts of the Holy Spirit. This was the word of knowledge. He was not in the adjacent village, but he was told by the Spirit that in the adjacent village there would be a donkey with its colt there tied. Just go and get it. And when the owner says, what are you doing? Just tell them the Lord has need of it. And that's exactly what happens. As they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, why are you loosing the colt? And they said, the Lord has need of him. And of course he said, okay. And they brought him to Jesus and they threw their own clothes on the colt. And they sat Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. Then as they were now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples, not the 12, all of them, the hundreds and hundreds that were now following this parade, as it were, down through the valley and in up through and to Jerusalem, the multitude of disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, the miracles, the feeding of the 5,000, the feeding of the other multitude, the casting out of devils, the raising of the dead, all of these manifestations of the present salvation of God, a picture of the future kingdom, and saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Now, again, an adaptation. Luke also records in the birth of Christ, glory to God in the highest and peace on earth and goodwill toward men. And so blessed is the King, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd. We miss this in the Matthew passage. Teacher, rebuke your disciples. And he answered and said to them, I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out. All of nature declares the glory of God. I remember years ago, Bryn and I were just babies, and I was studying for the ministry, our pastor preaching a sermon titled, No Rock's Gonna Praise You While I'm Around. I love that. And these disciples and these people in their great excitement are crying out, Hosanna, save now. Son of David, Messiah. And the Pharisees find this to be blasphemous. And they say, tell the crowd to stop it. And he says, I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out. And he drew near the city and he wept over it. Wow. He wept over the city. He looked at them. We also have in cross-reference a passage in which Jesus looked over the city and cried out, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets, I would have often gathered you together as a hen does her chicks, but you were unwilling." How tragic. And Jesus looks at the city and he weeps over it, knowing what's about to take place, knowing that he's going to be falsely accused. He's going to be rejected. He's going to be tried. He will be convicted, so to speak, in a human court, being worthy of death, but only God knew that he was sent for that very purpose, to lay down his life as the Passover lamb to be slain for the sin of the whole world. The announcement that John the Baptist had made, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world," Jesus is about to fulfill in this very time. And he looks over the city knowing that he would be rejected by them. Even those disciples that are now praising and singing and shouting, "Hosanna, save now," these same people later scatter. They're nowhere to be found. Why? Because he did not save them the way they wanted him to save them then. They had their own agenda. Save us from Rome. Save us from the tyranny of Rome. We want to be the head and not the tail. And the Lord knows that there is a day coming that he will make Israel the head and not the tail. He will save them. But it wasn't then. He came as a suffering servant, humble. And those people that were crying out, many of them turned and ran the other way. So he weeps over the city and he says, "If you had known, even you, especially in this your day, the things that make for your peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. For days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you and surround you and close you in on every side," just like we read in Psalm 118, "and level you and your children within you to the ground, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another, because you did not know the time of your visitation." Because you did not know the time. If you had known even this thy day, he just told them. What day is he talking about? Let's go to Daniel chapter 9. I'm going to make you work today. Daniel chapter 9, starting in verse 25 and 26. Daniel chapter 9, verse 25 and 26. If you want, just listen. Daniel has been in Babylon for 70 years. These children of Israel that had been taken to Babylon because of their earlier disobedience and refusal to obey the Lord, God told them that he would exile them from their own land. The city of Jerusalem has been destroyed. The wall wiped out, broken down. There's nothing there but ruins. And the people have been scattered, the northern tribes by the Assyrians, the southern tribes taken captive to Babylon. And now after the 70-year discipline, they have not repented. There's a few people who had repented, but others had become quite comfortable in Babylon. And Daniel cries out to the Lord, 70 years is over, now what? And the Lord sends the angel to him to tell him, not 70 years, 7 times 70 years, 490 years. And why? Because if they had repented, it would have been 70. But in the law, in the book of Leviticus, we read it in particular, if you do not repent, I will multiply your transgression 7 times. So he is going to not give them 70 years exile. He is going to tell them, you're going to have 490 years of discipline. And now he begins to break down what's going to take place for them. In verse 25, "Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks, a total of 69 weeks of years or heptads, so 483 years. Now, they would understand this. We require some explanation. Daniel would understand it very clearly. He communicated to the wise men. The wise men who saw his star in the east, that came to worship him. They would be aware of the time. Daniel was aware of the time. He was one of the wise men. He communicated these things. He told us here in the word. He told Israel then in the word. Know and understand. They were called to know and understand. If you had known even this thy day, the things that make for your peace. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until the Messiah, the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. They should have been able to calculate 483 years from the command to go back and restore and build Jerusalem. Now, some people confuse this with the restoration of the temple. That happened earlier. That is not what it says. Nehemiah was grieving. The Persian Empire, the Medo-Persian Empire, had already conquered the Babylonian Empire, but he is still there serving the king of Persia, and or in Babylon, but under the dominion of Persia, and he's grieving, and he's the cupbearer, he's serving the wine, and he goes in and he says, "Here's your glass of wine," and the king says, "What's the matter with you?" He says, "I've never seen you grieve like this." He says, "Well, I'm grieved for my city and my people." He says, "Well, what's going on?" He says, "Well, my city's in ruins." Now, the temple is being restored, but the city itself is still decimated. And he says, "I want to go. I want to work on my city." And he says, "Well, how long will it take? How long will you be gone?" And he is given permission. And you can read about this in Nehemiah chapter 2. Nehemiah chapter 2. And he is given a command to go and to rebuild the city and its walls. From that day, 483 years would pass until the day, Nisan 10, Sunday, we call Palm Sunday, Jesus rode into Jerusalem, to the day. And Jesus said, "You should have known this. This thy day, the things that make for your peace, but they are hidden from your eyes." Why? Because you're still serving yourself. And you're not serving God. And they have been hidden from you because you are unwilling to listen to God. Wow. An amazing prophecy. If you had known even this thy day, the things that make for your peace. One more thing I want to point out in prophecy. Let us go to Exodus chapter 12, I think it is, yeah. Exodus chapter 12. I told you I'm going to make you work today, huh? I will admit I heard a lot more pages in the first service. The later crowd with your apps that don't have that page-turning sound effect. Still looking for that. Love to hear the pages of the Bible turn. Exodus chapter 12. The children of Israel have been in Egypt. Egypt is a type of the world. God is going to deliver them following all these great plagues. There's problems in Israel and his dealings with Pharaoh and hardening Pharaoh's heart. Finally, we get to what would be the greatest and the last and the final plague before the deliverance of the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, a day we call Passover. The Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, "This month shall be your beginning of months." So we're changing the calendar. We're starting over. This month turns out to be the month of Nisan, the first in their annual festive holiday calendar. "This month shall be your beginning of months, and it shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, 'On the 10th of this month, every man shall take for himself a lamb, according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for a lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons according to each man's need, you shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. Jesus, John the Baptist said, is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. He is the fulfillment of the Passover lamb. And on the 10th of Nisan, 200,000 people, give or take, I mean, we don't know the numbers, took their little one-year-old, innocent, beautiful lamb into their homes on the 10th of Nisan. And Jesus, on the 10th of Nisan, was taken by this little colt into the city for observation for 4 days, just as was the little lamb to be in their homes for observation for 4 days. 4 days later, the little lamb at twilight would be killed. Listen, and they shall take, verse 6, now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month, then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. That's at the close of the day before it begins to become dark. It is around 3 p.m. That's exactly the time Jesus died at Calvary, on the 14th day of Nisan. The exact same time that all the children of Israel were killing the lambs, celebrating the Passover. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on the 2 doorposts of the lintel of the house where they eat it. And they shall eat the flesh on that night, roasted in fire with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs, they shall eat it. Do not eat it raw or boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire. So it has to be roasted in the fire. Fire is a picture of judgment in the Bible. We don't have time to give you the details of all of this. Its head and its legs and its entrails. You shall let none of it remain until morning. What remains until morning, you shall burn with fire. And thus you shall eat it with the belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. And I will pass through the land of Egypt on that day, and I will strike all the firstborn of the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord on all the land of Egypt. Egypt, a type of the world. Now, the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Man, what was he talking about when he said, if you had known even this thy day, the things that make for your peace, predicted 483 years earlier, to the very day, from the giving of the command, literally, to the day. I find it interesting that when people read this and they, of course, they look at a prophecy and say, there's one of the prophecies Jesus fulfilled, that it isn't enough evidence for some. You know, there's a day coming when Jesus will actually ride in through the Eastern Gate. And he will come, not lowly, riding on a colt of a donkey, but he will come in great power. And every eye shall see him, and all the nations shall mourn because of him. And he will come to save then Israel, who are surrounded by the nations, and it will appear as though they're going to be completely wiped out, and he is going to intervene and save them. Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. But that couldn't happen unless first he had come lowly, and we would say, this is the day that the Lord has made. The day that this suffering would happen, the day that this rejection would happen, we will rejoice and be glad in it. Why? Because the preaching of the cross is to us who believe the power of God. Amen. But when he comes at the time of the second coming, he will come to establish his earthly kingdom as Son of David. He will sit on the throne of David. He will be Messiah and King of kings and Lord of lords. And all the nations will worship him initially. But even seeing with their eyes the king, some people say, well, I don't believe in God. I can't see him. You'll be able to see him. Every eye will see him. Well, I don't know about Israel. I don't know about the future of Israel. I don't know if Israel is really the head of the nation. There's no dispute. Everyone on the earth is going to know. And even after a 1,000-year physical, literal reign of Christ on the earth, the number of the sands of the sea are going to be deceived by Satan when he is loosed again for a little season, and they will create a war against Christ. Crazy. Why? Because we have our own agenda. We want it our way. We want him to be our errand boy. We have forgotten that he is sovereign. He is God and we are not. And somebody will say, well, all those prophecies fulfilled by then, people should know. Hey, the number of prophecies still don't convince people today. We should all know. There should be no debate. The whole earth today should be able to study the prophecies and say, we know that there is a Messiah, and his name is Jesus, and we know that he is the Savior of the world. He is the Passover Lamb. Look, he fulfilled the prophecy of riding into Jerusalem on the exact day told 483 years earlier, and he was in Jerusalem for 4 days. He was observed and then he was killed and he died exactly at twilight on the 14th, fulfilling the prophecy. That should be enough. And still be like, I don't want to serve God. Really? Some people say, well, those two prophecies should be enough. And I want to just point something out to you guys. There are listed for us by scholars, people that have done their homework, that suggest that there are 365 specific prophecies concerning Christ's first coming that were fulfilled exactly. And I would like to suggest to you that there are more than 365, that we are yet to discover the number of prophecies in their exact fulfillment. And I want to illustrate that with this one passage today in closing. Let me tell you just what is called in the list of 365, one fulfillment of prophecy, triumphal entry. And let me just tell you what happened at the triumphal entry in my own long sentence that I'll read to you, so just hear me out. It is certainly poor grammar, I'm certain, and a run-on sentence that needs colons, semicolons, and periods. Here it is. A sinless Jewish man, that's three things, sinless, Jewish, and man, okay? Just follow along. From the tribe of Judah, of the lineage of David, named Jesus, who is known as a prophet, will ride a colt of a donkey into the city of Jerusalem through the eastern gate on Nisan 10, exactly 483 years to the day as predicted by Daniel, to be hailed as king and pleaded with for salvation over a city over which he weeps is 15 items. 15 things. Now, they call that one prophecy, triumphal entry. I can find 15 graphic details, all of which he fulfilled perfectly. Now, if you read your bulletin later, you'll note that I wrote about Dr. Stoner. Dr. Stoner wrote a book called Science Speaks. Thank you, dear. And in the book, he details the statistical analysis as a mathematician concerning the 365 prophecies fulfilled accurately by Jesus and perfectly and in its perfect timing, and shows that the chances of these prophecies being fulfilled would be 10 to the 28th power. That's 10 with 28 zeros behind it. We don't even know how to say it. But he, in trying to help people understand the graphic nature of what he's saying, he says, let's just take 10 to the 17th power to give you an example. He said, if you took 10 to the 17th power silver dollars and you put them on the state of Texas 2 feet deep, you know how big the state of Texas is, 2 feet deep, and you took a guy and blindfolded him and send him off into Texas. And randomly he reaches down and picks up one silver dollar. And the one silver dollar that he picks up happens to be the one that would earlier been marked. One chance in 10 to the 17th power. That would be the same of Jesus only fulfilling the first eight. The first eight of 365 specific prophecies, and still men don't believe. And why? Because man has made himself his own God. And we must remember, he is God, we are not. And when we say, God, do this for me, and he says, no, he's God. He says, God, do this for me. And he says, not now. And we say, well, then we're not going to serve you anymore. It doesn't lessen his godness. He's still God. See, I don't believe in God. I love the movie that The Count of Monte Cristo, I think it is, where the guy is kind of an atheist and he gets tricked and he goes to Chateau d'If. It's this prison on an island. And there's this old priest in there, and he digs through underground. He comes up, and he finds the priest, and they get to be friends. And near the end of the priest's life, he says, God bless you. The priest is going to die. And he says, God bless you. And Jim Caviezel plays the Count of Monte Cristo. He says, I don't believe in God. And the old priest says, well, he believes in you. See, if you don't believe in God, it doesn't change who he is. He's still God. And if you had known even this thy day, the things that make for thy peace. See? Man, you guys. It's not your work trying to convince people. You've got the facts. You've got the evidence. The Christian faith is not faith in something that we think we might know. It is a faith in what we absolutely know. And when people say, I don't want to serve God, it's because of the rebellion of their own hearts. And because they are their own God. And I'm going to leave you with this note. He is God. And we are not. And for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen? Amen. Let's stand together as we pray. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for your blessing. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this truth. Teach us, challenge us, grow us. Encourage us and let us be ready always to give an answer to everyone that asks of us for the hope that lies within us with meekness and fear. In Jesus' name, amen.